I'll be now introducing the next speaker for the day, Dr. Anjali Dable.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, she is practicing consultant surgeon at Nanded since 2002. She is a current executive member of MASI since 6 years and current executive member of APSI. She is in joint academic convener of International Society of Coloproctology and ex-executive committee member of Hernia Society of India. She'll be talking on breast lump evaluation, triple assessment. Over to you, Dr. Anjali.
Yes. Am I audible, madam?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's a proud privilege on this platform to be associated with Jawaharlal Nehru Medical College and the Association of Breast Surgeons of India. I am in the midst of the two institutes where we want to give educating breast, where the medical school starts educating many surgeons, and Association of Breast Surgeons of India is doing an excellent job being a West Zone member and association of this since the ABC has finalized its APSI module. It's my proud privilege to be associated with Dr. Yevla Madam since long, and being a head of department of Department of Surgery at Jawaharlal Nehru Medical College, she has taken immense efforts to come this to happening. Second, I am very much thankful that Dr. Raghuram, although he has promised us to be here, but because he has been stuck in the OT for some axillary dissection, which is very critical, he has just called me and conveyed that I am sorry for could not join into this meeting. But still, in this hard time, Dr. Raghuram sir, who is a current president of ASI, has promised and he has conveyed best wishes for this CME. Thirdly, I am very thankful to my mentor, Dr. Abhay Dalvi sir, who has taken immense efforts and regarding any education scenario where the upcoming budding surgeons, how should be your practical approach, he is doing and he is going to do through various association, and now sir is incoming president for the ASI. I am very much thankful, sir, for your guiding words. Fourthly, the secretary of the ABSI, Dr. Ashwin Kumar, we are thankful that you have also been active and you have given a positive energy to making this happen. Everybody from the Department of Surgery, Jawaharlal Nehru Medical College, Dr. Darshana Madam, you are also have done immense efforts. Every PG student, every person from your department, I am very much thankful. Moving to today's topic, the APSI module, how should be your approach to the breast lump? Now, triple assessment of the breast is very much a concept which is not very old or not new, but over the time period, we could see that the approach to the breast lump has changed a little bit since years together. Now, why it is important to have any breast lump to have the triple assessment? That it has three factors associated with it. Now, as a medical college students, you must be admitting that your PG guide or your senior teachers, they must have been told to us that even by touching the breast, I could say whether this is benign or this is malignant. But my dear friends, the clinical efficacy of or the positive predictive value of only clinical examination is just 50 to 60%, and adding to the investigation like ultrasound, like MRI whenever required, it gives a 100% predictive value, so that we are not over treating or under treating any lump associated in the breast. So that is the aspect that we have. Now, as you could see, that palpable breast lump risk of harboring cancer in each lump is 10%. When it is associated with nipple discharge as a predominant clinical feature, the positivity of malignancy is less than 5%, and it is more if the discharge is serous. Mastalgia has a negligible role or as a clinical presentation, but when it goes to an advanced disease, definitely it will have a role. Now, dominant breast abnormality, as we are moving from an aberration in normal involution and development, in this phase of breast development, regression, and active reproduction, these are active three physiological stages of the breast, where the breast will have enormous see in this figure that 80 to 85% of the diseases are benign, and almost 10% of the diseases are, or the lump in the breast, are malignant. But to have 10% knowledge of the malignancy, we should be able to do firstly the 90% diseases the best care possible, so that it should not be undertreated or overtreated. Unless and until we know the physiology of any lump associated in this benignity, or when this benign lump is going to turn into a malignancy or a borderline malignancy, unless until we know this, we cannot treat every cancer to its best. Now, in this triple assessment, why it is important? What are the components of it? Clinical examination. Not only clinical examination, the thorough history associated with the clinical examination. Implication of why it has happened so. Why the nipple is retracted? Why there is pude orange appearance? Secondly, ultrasound examination. Ultrasound examination is nowadays considered as an extended clinical examination, which is very, very important in each and every case of the breast. Unless until you do it, the breast lump examination is not complete. And thirdly, associated with either a pathological investigation like FNAC or core needle biopsy and X-ray mammography. These are three various factors under which we are going to discuss what is triple assessment. Now, in this triple assessment, the mammography or ultrasound, the X-ray mammography and ultrasound, these are two very important factors after the clinical examination and the history, because you could know the disease in thorough, whether it has associated with the bilateral disease, whether it has extended to axilla, whether it is benign, whether it is borderline, and it has also the, whichever your hand could not see, the mammogram or the ultrasound could make you visible. And regarding the pathological investigation, we could have FNAC or core needle biopsy. So triple assessment is discussing all these three factors in each and every separately we are going to discuss. Now, triple assessment in this, the clinical examination or the thorough clinical examination and the thorough history for any PG student of the surgery is very important, because in every long case or short case, you are going to have this breast lump as a case presentation. Whenever you have been asked, how will you proceed? Your answer should be, unless and until I do triple assessment of the breast, I could not give the final diagnosis whether this is benign or malignant. And even though the lump is benign, we have to have the triple assessment. And even if it is malignant, we have to have the triple assessment. Now, triple assessment has made the breast practice to reach to some standardization, so that at every level, whether it is a tertiary level, whether it is a primary level, your approach is going to more or less same. That is actually the importance of the triple assessment. Now, in the history itself, what is important factors that you should look for? One is the onset of the lump. Second is the progression of the lump. And thirdly, the associated features associated with this onset and progression. These are three very important factors when you go into the history or examination of the breast lump. Regarding the menstrual history and importance in the breast lump or the breast diseases, the menarche is at what age the patient has attained menarche, that is optimal safety period is between 14, but it is considered as less risky between 12 to, if it is less than 12 years menarche has been attained, that is actually the risk factor. So such important points you should learn, that the parity. Now, if the patient has multiple abortions, is it a risk factor or is it going to be a protective factor? So number of abortion is itself a risk factor. Why? Because abortion and pregnancy has a difference, that the estrogen regulatory mechanism is absent in abortion, whereas in the pregnancy, we have a controlled estrogen reactivity, so that it is going to have a protective effect on the breast. So number of abortion, the risk of the breast cancer increases. At what age the patient has first childbirth, that is also very, very important. Breastfeeding, which is actually a protective shell around each female. What is optimal breastfeeding? That should be 1 year. What is least protective? That is 6 months. And what is the maximal breastfeeding is you if given up to 2 years, that is going to give you the maximum protection. So your answer should be the 1 year is the optimal breastfeeding. History of OC pills. Now, in the old periods, if you could understand that the OC pills which were having the high estrogen content, they were actually the risk factor. And if these OC pills are taken in the late periods, like after 40, they are used to be risk factor. But because now availability of the low estrogen oral contraceptive pills, now it has become a less risk factor. Hormone replacement therapy is again a very important risk factor irrespective of the age. So in the history taking, you should have what type of hormone treatment for what, after hormone treatment, what was her menstrual history, like that you should progress so that the estrogen reactivity can be assessed in each of the hormone replacement therapy. Familial history of the breast cancer in this regard, as maximum students here are the postgraduate surgery students. There is no significant family history. By saying this sentence, I think that is not going to protect you. The detailed family history, like the longevity of the disease, what was the progression when it was detected, not only the history of the breast cancer, but associated ovarian cancer in the family, associated prostatic cancer in the males, what was actually the age of detection of the first breast cancer. Because if, for example, the first breast cancer detected in the family is at the age of 50, then the screening of the rest of the family members should start at the age of minus 10, that is at the age of the 40. So these are some of the important aspects which are necessary whenever you are taking a long history taking of the breast lump. Clinical examination. It has multiple factors, like what is the status of the breast present. Always compare it with the opposite normal breast. Unless and until you compare it with the normal breast, may it be MRI, may it be ultrasound, may it be clinical examination, your examination is not complete. And what are the various positions in which we examine? Looking at this picture, the various disease progression, that how the skin, the nipple, the underneath structures, they are involved into the disease. The most common factor is appearance and the tearing or the retraction. Now, pure orange appearance of the breast, is it only seen in malignancy? No. Pure orange appearance basically can be benign conditions also, like breast abscess, like chronic mastitis, like tuberculosis. What is importance of pude orange? Pude orange actually involvement of the subdermal lymphatics. By involving subdermal lymphatics, it reaches to the axillary lymph nodes. But while reaching to the axillary lymph node, the lymphatic channels, they get blocked, and the skin follicles, they get involved, that give the pude orange appearance to the skin. So pude orange appearance can be associated with the benign diseases, but when it comes to the tethering or the retraction of the nipple or the skin, that is secondary to the involvement of the ligaments, the Cooper's ligament of the breast, and that includes, that shows us the invasion of the disease, that is very, very important. So retraction, pude or the tethering, that is a sign of malignancy, but pude orange with malignancy, that is important. Discharge, nipple discharge. Now, previously we have been taught that any bloody nipple discharge or the discharge with the RBCs is very risk factor for the malignancy. But the micro invasion techniques like microductoscopy, like various X-ray mammography tools, the sonography sophisticated probes, we could know that blood in the nipple discharge is usually seen in 90% of the cases secondary to the nipple papilloma. And whenever you find that the discharge is serous, serosanguinous, it is from the single duct, it is from the single site, and it is spontaneous, you should suspect for the malignancy. The triple assessment of the breast has a gold standard of the breast cancer diagnosis. Now, what is basically a gold standard for any procedure? We have been hearing since long since our MBBS days and PG days that we always compare with the gold standard. And once reading this, I have come across a story of gold standardness, and then they have mentioned there that gold, which is a attracting metal or attracting tool for everybody, and there the name has been started for any clinical evaluation. We have been seen that previously excisional biopsy was the gold standard. After that, the short open biopsy was the gold standard. So science and diagnosis for any disease is evolving science. The gold standard cannot be a permanent or a marker. So it is a changing scenario, and there comes the gold standard of the breast cancer diagnosis is always triple assessment, and the maximum predictive value of triple assessment is 99.99%, which is unable to be seen if we combine only clinical examination an extra mammography. What is the positive predictive value? It is less than 50%. So any two combination will give a less accuracy, and we want 100% reliable diagnosis so as to reach to a cancer diagnosis or whether it is a benign lump. As previous speaker Dr. Rohit Kumar has already told that the progression of the lump, the basically what we are trying to do by making awareness campaigns is that the smaller the smaller the size when the lump is detected, the best results we can give. And that is the most important message we want to give to the medical colleagues and the society. X-ray mammography, which is the best examining or the screening tool in the breast, how it is done. The mammography is a very sensitive and specific examination for the breast. How it is done, every PG student should once go and see into the mammography room, how the breast has been compressed, what is actually the cassette, where it is compressed, what is the compression pressure which is applied, what is the position given to the patient, and what are the two optimal views. Now, in any X-ray mammography, we look for two views. One is a craniocaudal view. Naturally, the name indicates from the clavicle to the subcostal margin. This is view is. In the craniocaudal view, you are going to see the pectoral muscle only at the middle part of the X-ray, while mediolateral oblique view is going to tell us about the pectoralis major is completely seen on the mediolateral oblique view and associated with axilla. Now, the CC view. It is actually, imagine that when breast is compressed vertically between the two plates, how you are going to look at the cut section in the breast. There you try to imagine that your lump is in which quadrant and how you are going to correlate this lump into the MLO view. So the importance is some lumps are detected in the craniocaudal view, and if the partial part of the lump is detected in the one view, the complete lump can be visible on the another view. So how to have the proper alignment of the MLO view and the CC view, unless until these two views you are correlation, then only you could know how is the extent of the lump. Now, regarding the X-ray mammography, there are various aspects to it that whenever the breast is too dense, if the breast is having low fat and more density, then the X-ray mammography is going to give you a very, very bad effect. So every lump cannot be detected on X-ray mammography. So does it mean that X-ray mammography, if it is nil or if it is null, patient is out of risk? Not at all. Even though if X-ray mammography has shown a no lump, and if you could feel something positive in your clinical examination, you should always go for the next examination. So we have definitely a 3 to 4 grades in defining the density of the breast, density or the fat. These are the two important markers which will decide whether ultrasound is the best investigation or the X-ray mammography is going to be the best investigation. So more denser the breast, ultrasound is the best. More fatty is the breast, X-ray mammography is the best tool. So in this way, we should learn. The CC view and the MLO view, they should be aligned over each other. Always see for the whether size has been mentioned on the X-ray film or not. Ideally, It should be bilateral. There should be always two views. The good mammogram should cover all the breast in both the views. The back-to-back x-rays have to be aligned so that we could know which quadrant has been involved. So these are well-taken views. Now, which quadrant has been involved? If you could see in the above craniocaudal view, you could see the only partial part of the lump and some more information you could get in the MLO view. Now, types of breast. Dense breast, 50-50 breast is 50% of the fat and 50% of the density. And here it is the fatty replaced breast. So as the age advances, the breast becomes is going to get fatty and fatty. And as the patient is younger, her breast is going to be dense. So it has been said that for younger patients less than 30 years, ultrasound examination is must. And patients who are above 40, the X-ray mammography is the ideal tool for investigating such patient. So depending upon density, you have to decide, like in the X-ray mammography, you are going to have a white background. And whenever you are reading any X-ray mammography, the image or the lump which is going to be seen there, that is going to have again a white image. Either it is lump or either it is a microcalcification. So anything which is going to be seen white on the white background is going to give you a bad image. So whenever the breast is fatty, you could get a total black background and a white image that could be clearly seen. Whereas in the dense breast, on the white background, white lump is a poor indicator. So I think with this, I have made clear that less than 30 year ultrasound is must in fatty, in dense breast, and above 40 or as the female is reaching towards the menopause, it gets fatty. Then in such cases, mammography is best. Now, sensitivity of the mammography, 85% to 90% in the fatty replaced breast and 65% in the dense breast. So, dense breast, they have to be seen in the ultrasound. Because in as we have already discussed that the mass and calcification are the important factors that we are going to look for in the X-ray. The secondary signs of the cancer on the mammography, although we usually the first site we see for the microcalcification and the lump, but secondary important factors seen on mammography have to be read, like nipple inversion. Yes, you could see on the X-ray mammography. Architectural distortion, this is going to tell us about whether we can go ahead with the BCT or not. Whether there is a skin thickening, how much is the skin thickening. So if at all you are planning for the skin sparing mastectomy, this is again going to give you a surgically assessed tool. Axillary adenopathy, definitely if the axilla, axillary lymph node, the calcification has reached, or if they have totally lost the architecture, then these lymph nodes can also be seen on the X-ray mammography. So tissue asymmetry, developing neodensity, the skin retraction, all these factors you try to read on the mammography units. And the minimum or the maximum mammography dose limit should always be mentioned on the X-rays. Now, BI-RADS, breast imaging reporting and the data system. Why this is important? BI-RADS system is basically established that it is making us the standardization of the breast practice so as to have the patient whenever it is reaching to us, either it has been seen by a primary level consultant or a PhD doctor or a tertiary center, the almost your lump evaluation should be at a basic level, 1 ±1, so that we can give the best results to the patient to get the optimal diagnosis. Now, such breast imaging or such reading scales are in every scenario. Like we have liver reporting and data system. We have testicular reporting and data system. So every organ has its own level of reading. Now, if your BI-RADS category is zero, does that mean that this patient is out of risk? No, not at all. Even though this zero BRADS classification is there, it has some important value that it needs additional imaging. So, my dear friends, BRADS thing you should learn, and for this BRADS category understanding, you should visit to the ultrasound room or the X-ray room and to radiologist frequently, so as to have the proper three-way diagnosis of any breast lump. Now, triple assessment, the ultrasound has very immense role, because with advancing knowledge and advancement of the breast diseases, the ultrasound, which is ideally available at every grassroots level, and because of the availability of the ultrasound at every level of the hospital, and APSI, I think, has done more whichever training modules are available in the APSI conferences, they have specially made every APSI member some workshops regarding the how to do ultrasound, how to read the breast lump on the ultrasound. And as we could as Dr. Abhay Darvi sir and Dr. Raghuram sir were also here, so ASI should also make it a compulsory event that all the surgeons, how they could get the ultrasound machine in their clinic. Because of the PCP NDT, we have a great challenges for practitioner or for any surgeon or non-OBGY person to get into the ultrasound techniques, but you have to fight for that. And I think if there is way, if there is will, there is way, definitely. So ultrasound examination is very important. In this ultrasound, if the patient has a dense breast, ultrasound is going to help you. Now, there are certain terminologies in the breast like echogenicity. This echogenicity is going to give you a lot of value, whether it is a hypoechoic or whether it is a heteroechoic. So hypoechoic, a bit, when you are always comparing any lesion detected in the breast with the rest of the parenchyma of the breast. So these are some of the terminologies which you have to learn whenever you are reading any lump on the ultrasound. So the usefulness of the ultrasound, it is actually the test of choice in less than 35. The lump during pregnancy and the lactation, yes, you can do safely, in which cases the X-ray mammography could not be done. But nowadays, if it is a DCIS-like thing, then with the shield, they are advising with the protective shield that patient can undergo the X-ray mammography. But less than 35, we always try to go with the ultrasound. The evaluating mammo abnormality, breast mass with a negative mammography, it is important tool. You can have an interventional guidance if you learn the ultrasound techniques like crooked biopsy. If it is a deep-seated lump, you can definitely have an ultrasound guided techniques, the cyst aspiration technique, the breast implants, and various advantages of the breast ultrasound are there. So the linear frequency of the probe, the small linear probe is used, 5 to 12 megahertz, and patient should be in the lying down position with the both arms raised. Now, whenever you are documenting any ultrasound image or giving reporting to the patient, you have to have in your hand some printed report like this or a printed schematic diagram in your hand, so that whenever you are saying that lump is in so and so position, always the quadrant is actually may not be comfortable with everybody, because breast is not a water compartment like portion where you can have a compartment or a quadrant. So try to go the diagonally, that 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 9 o'clock, in between 3 to 6. Such format should be developed in documenting the breast lesions. Benign characteristics of any solid lesion, you should always try to look for hyperechogenicity. What are the margins? What is shape? So more the transversely placed lump, they are more of benign. Now look at this image. It is jet black. This is a cyst or like a bladder. So as you go and as you see multiple ultrasounds in the sonography department, the moment you see, you could be able to diagnose. But it requires a practice. So unless and until the ultrasound of the breast you have mastered, it will add value to your clinical examination, because ultrasound is nothing but an extra extended clinical examination. Look at this cyst. This is a complicated cyst which has multiple septa inside. And this, if you send the aspirate of these contents, you could able to see that whether it is a benign or what type of cellularity is within. This is an abscess or galactosyl. These are hyperechoic lesions, although they are not clearly hypoechoic. But looking at the dense echoes in this picture and the regular margins, you could see that it is a benign in nature. The fibroadenomas, which are actually the lump which are developed in the development of the breast, they are usually seen in between less than 30 years of the patient. So fibroadenomas may have a complicated scenario in some of the conditions, but fibroadenomas are usually transversely placed and they usually have an posterior enhancement that is very, very important. Malignant characteristics of the lump are, they are markedly hypoechoic, they have a mixed echogenicity, they have a speculation. What is speculation? That is irregularity, or they have some spikes like thorns over the lump that you, or you could practice over a number of ultrasound images. They will not have a parallel orientation because the transversely placed lump, they will have the two axes which run parallel to each other. Microlobulations are seen into the malignant characteristics of lump, whereas in the benign lump, you will always have a macrolobulation and which is very, very smooth. The calcifications which are seen in the malignant lump, they are microcalcification. They could also be detected on the ultrasound if patient has certain special characteristics. Now look at this lump as compared to the previous fibroadenoma, benign lump. This lump which has irregularity, which has a dispersity, which has heterogeneity, which has invasion, and which has multiple calcific spots, which is not a very, very regular and smooth margin. So looking at this aspect, you could know what is malignancy and what is benign. So to have the summarize, less than 20 years of the patient, always ultrasound, clinical examination with ultrasound is going to give you the best results. If the patient is between 20 to 30 years, first do ultrasound. If on ultrasound you could not able to diagnose completely, take the help of the X-ray mammography. If the patient is between, and if the family history of mother or sister, there is no family history, then you should go for first ultrasound followed by X-ray mammography as and when required. But when the patient is above 40 years, you should go for first the X-ray mammography followed by ultrasound. Pregnancy and lactation, ultrasound is always safe. So this should be your approach. Now, the American Society of Cancer has established again, a third line of investigation after ultrasound, after X-ray mammography is MRI. But dear friends, to tell that MRI is not available in all of the medical colleges, but MRI has definitely added value to the breast conserving surgery. Sometimes it has been said that MRI is rich man's ultrasound, and MRI has also disadvantages that it gives you a micro invasive picture by which you the BCT rates having been reduced down, and you have to do, sometimes you are planning for BCT and after MRI you do either a neoadjuvant chemotherapy or you have to go for the MRM. So MRI also has a definitive role of investigation into the triple assessment, but into the special characteristics like BRCA mutation positive, untested first degree relative where the BRCA carrier is there, lifetime cancer risk associated with the family, radiation to the chest between the age of 30 years. So you can have whether it is arising from the chest wall or not, like Lee Fromany syndrome, in which the bone and the soft tissue and the skeletal metastasis is usually seen. And this is a genetic inherited disease which is seen in the younger families. And Cowden syndrome, in which the hamartomas disease, which looks like a benign disease, but in some of the cases it has been seen that in the younger age group, this can turn into malignancy. So these are some of the special situations where you have to consider that MRI also has definitively a role into the investigation. Again, search for the occult breast cancer with known metastasis, monitoring response to the chemotherapy to evaluate the patients with positive margins or immediate post-op residual lesion. Early detection of local recurrence can be seen on the MRI and even implant integrity or to detect the cancer or sometimes the rupture of the implant, or whenever you need to change the implant, you can have various guidelines on depending upon the MRI. Now, there is a new entity, what is multifocal and what is multicentricity. Now, multifocality and multicentricity is actually a term which has come with the advancing breast conserving surgery over the time period. Previously, we old surgeons used to describe any lump associated into the upper medial quadrant or lower lateral quadrant. But as we have seen that these quadrants are not having a definite septum inside, multifocality is if two tumors associated in the breast having less than 5 cm distance, it is called as a multifocal. And when it is called as multicentric, when the two tumors, they have more centimeter or at the distance of 5 cm, by this multifocality and multicentricity, you could know what is the actually BCT or MRM, or is the patient is going to have recurrence. So somebody can say quadrant, somebody can say multifocality or centricity. So these are some of the special situations where searched for the primary tumor or demonstrate for the existing lesion and to differentiate between the postoperative scar versus recurrence, because patient has taken radiotherapy postoperatively, the total breast has been puckered to the chest wall. In such situation, even X-ray and ultrasound don't able to tell you that where is actually the problem, whether problem is at scar level or whether it is at chest level. In such situations, MRI is going to solve your problem. So it is a problem solving tool. Good triple assessment avoids open biopsies. Now, FNAC and the core needle biopsy, these are very much important investigation, and now core needle biopsy has completely replaced FNAC. Yes, it is, but because FNAC has an operative dependent sensitivity and specificity, more negative, false negative rates, and therefore the hormonal assessment gradually has taken a big lead, in which the biology of any breast tumor has to be treated before surgery. That scenario has changed us completely, and therefore core needle biopsy is ideally into the triple assessment. So it avoids big scars and it can avoid two procedures. How to do the core needle biopsy? Now, this core needle biopsy was first described by the Pellengren in the Sweden. The cutting needle fits in the automated spring-loaded biopsy gun. Actually, it takes the slice of the breast lump. Before doing a core needle biopsy, you should always try on some of the outside specimens like either a potato, so that how it has to be operated to avoid the disastrous complications like lung damage or the pleura damage can be avoided. Because once you fire the spring within, it gets so fastly dismantled and you can have an accident. So it should be done under the proper guidance. That is very, very important. If possible, under ultrasound guidance, if the lump is deeply associated, can give you the best results. So how to do core needle biopsy? As a surgery resident, you must be knowing, after taking all the aseptic precautions, the most important thing is that the core needle biopsy has to be taken in a transverse direction. It should always parallel to the chest wall. It should not be angulated to the chest wall to avoid the damage. How many core needle biopsies? Maximum 5, minimum 5, maximum 7. What is the ideal core? If that core floats on your water, it is not good. If it dips in, that is actually a good core. So try to understand that why it floats over the water, because there can be a chance that you have taken the fat of the breast, or either it is not a complete core. So the core which dips inside is a good core, and send it under proper aseptic precautions and added formalin. The triple assessment has, FNAC has certain disadvantages like insufficient material. That is actually, we have seen the many pathologists, they say that the material was insufficient, so they could not come to diagnosis. Requires an experienced cytologist. FNAC has disadvantage that it will not tell you whether the disease was invasive or not, and we are not going to have the ERPR status of the patient so as to plan the new adjuvant. Now you will ask me, being a student of the medical college, if you are going to have 100% coronal biopsy, then what is the role of FNAC? But my dear friends, FNAC has to be practiced in the staging of the axillary lymph node. Like once we have done the coronal biopsy of the breast lump, we have seen that the diagnosis finalized. We want to assess the axilla. Multiple lymph nodes are seen. Some are grade 1, some are grade 3. In assessing the complete axilla, there is definitely a role of USG-guided FNAC in the axillary staging. Now, triple assessment has coronal biopsy has certain advantages, like I already we have seen. So check if any patient has on warfarin or clopidogrel, because it can have a hematoma or bleeding from the root cut side that has to be checked. Pneumothorax accidentally happens. So first try to learn how to spring fires and all necessary safety precautions before taking into the hand the triple gun biopsy. Now, the clinical examination, mammography, and the coronal biopsy. This gives you the efficacy or the positive optimal value of around 99.99%. Now, this is a basically our chart where what is the role of clinical examination. Sensitivity is around 60% in the clinical scenario, while as with the addition of radiological examination, it goes to around 80 to 90%. And combining this all is going to give you the maximal optimal results, so that no patient is undertreated or overtreated. Vacuum-assisted biopsy are gaining importance in the metro cities, but still it will take more time as the cost of the vacuum-assisted devices is much more. Stereotactic biopsy is actually a need of time in various institutes, but stereotactic biopsy in has cost to it on and in the medical college or the district surgeons, we have to focus more on the early detection of the cancer, which is itself a challenge for us. So still that will require more time. So my dear friends, take home messages are: good history and clinical examination is very, very important. Symptomatic women over the age of 35 should get a mammogram and breast ultrasound done. Women under 35 years should get an ultrasound examination first. Use ultrasound to guide the procedures. Learn ultrasound from your radiological colleagues. Use some catalogs. And unless until you try to read or try to see the every lump into ultrasound, as a surgeon, it is very easy for us to diagnose. Coronal biopsy is always better than FNAC. With a good triple assessment, open biopsies and excisional biopsies can be avoided. So with this, I conclude my talk. And thank you very much. I think I have extended the time. And in this scenario for this platform, I have forgotten to mention the name of Dr. Godet sir, who is a mentor and patron to many of us. So thank you very much again. Therewith, I conclude my talk, madam.
Dr. Anjali?
Yes, madam.
Dr. Ketkar here. Excellent presentation. Thank you so much for such a complete lecture.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am.
Hello. Madam, yes. Anjali, madam.
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah, I got one question to you, please.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible to you, madam?
Yes, yes, very clear, sir. Very
yeah.
Clear.
Now, suppose you told there is a triple assessment. Yes. We just got three components. One is clinical examination. Second is whatever core needle biopsy or FNAC. And third is imaging. Okay.
Yes.
Now, suppose there is a case scenario like stage 3 disease.
Yes.
Clinically, stage 3 or stage 4.
Yes. So
what is the role of mammography when FNAC has or core needle biopsy has diagnosed the disease? As
yes.
a carcinoma, whatever carcinoma.
Yes,
so
sir.
What is the advantage of mammography or ultrasound? Because what extra knowledge you will get to treat this patient? Because already diagnosis in your hand. And
yes.
this patient is not going for BCP.
So yes.
You are directly going for palliative or your neoadjuvant or any radical surgery.
Right.
So what is the, is it a compulsory mammography needed in this patient?
Sir, very good question. But these are the actually challenges where we are getting only the palpable and advanced breast disease lesions. Yes, I agree with you, sir. Because stage 3 disease, there is no role in like whether you will do X-ray mammography or not, definitely. But always it should be done for the opposite breast, sir. That is one. It should be X-ray mammography.
Yeah, that I do agree.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But I agree with you, sir. That for the stage 3 disease. Yes, sir. I agree with you. And secondly, for progression of the disease, sir.
Dr. Anjali.
Okay.
Yes.
Dr. Anjali.
Yes, ma'am.
I am Dr. Pushpa, gynecologist. Yes. Just want to know, unmarried girl of 18 years. With the two small fibroid in of the breast.
Okay.
Clinical examination and ultrasound examination showing those two. What is the next approach to that girl?
Okay.
How now, often ultrasound or what else to be done?
Okay. Now, unmarried girl of 18 years, na madam?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And family history of the breast, cancer breast with grandmother.
Okay. Now, fibroadenomas actually is a disease of young age group, yes. Fibroadenoma is a diagnosis of ultrasound and clinical examination. But both done, your histopathological report is fibroadenoma. Biopsy is not done. So, ideally, the standard practice is, madam, you should go for the core needle biopsy. Okay. That is one. If the lump is less, more than 3 centimeter, lump is more than 3 centimeter, you can excise with the consent of the patient, but excision is not mandatory. You can observe, because fibroadenoma are the lumps which are actually the fibroepithelial hyperplastic lesions. That is one, madam. Secondly, if there is a strong family history of the breast cancer, considering that, madam, you can teach that patient how to do self-examination. That is one. You can train that patient what are the warning signs that for that she should immediately concern to you that sudden increase in the size of the lesion. That is one. Second, the invasiveness associated with the skin changes. And third thing is whether she has a nipple discharge or any additional feature to the previous, she should consult, madam. That should be your approach. Fourth thing is, madam, once she has married, suppose for example in this scenario we try to imagine that the lump is static. If you have detected at the size of 2.5 centimeter over the periods, the fibroadenoma is of 2.5 centimeter. It has peaked quite. So don't disturb it. But if the patient's family history member who has been detected for the malignancy at the age of 40 years, then she should start the X-ray mammography from the age of 30 years. So that is important. So
my question is, now should we follow up with the ultrasonography every 6 months one? And secondly, it is not in centimeters. It is just a millimeter, about 0.5.
So you need not have to do it. Yeah, you can have an ultrasound, madam. Ultrasound guided on self-examination. Both things are important, madam.
And so core biopsy is a must.
Core biopsy is a must, madam.
Okay. Yes. Thank you so much. Your presentation was excellent.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Anjali, ma'am. I would like to request K sir to add on some comments.
Dr. Anjali Davle has nicely inaugurated the subject of evaluation of lump and importance of triple assessment in an excellent manner and in details discussion in a simple language. She told us that triple assessment is gold standard and positive specificity is 99%, more than 99%. But she told in detail about importance of history, the onset of lump, progression of lump, and associated feature. She also discussed about importance of breastfeeding, OCP, HRT, and in detail about family history, if patient family history has history of any cancer, breast, or ovarian cancer or carcinoma prostate, then how we should go ahead with the triple assessment. And she told that core needle biopsy has almost replaced FNAC. So we should rely more on coronary biopsy rather than FNSA. Thanks, Dr. Anjali, for discussing evaluation of the breast lump and triple assessment in a simple way. I think question answer session has already been over. If anybody wants to ask any question, he is free to ask.
Sir, I would like to ask one question. May I?
Yes, yes.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Madam, I am Dr. Shinde.
Yes.
Now, previously there were so many classification or the staging criteria for breast malignancy like Columbia and all this. Where tethering, puckering, fixing the skin to anterior, fixing skin to the lump, they're important for classification or staging. In
yes.
the current scenario, is the importance of fixity of the skin or the tethering of the skin to the lump in current
yes.
scenario? Because there are only two criteria for labeling it as a anterior fixation is the nodules or the ulcerations.
Yes.
So in such situation, looking for, okay, it's for clinical examination for to look occurring or the tethering is okay.
Yes.
But
yes.
does it carry any importance for the staging of the disease? And
yes.
second
yes.
thing is, I would like to add one thing in the stage 3 or the stage 4 malignancy of the breast. Mammography may help in the situation where you want to see the response to the chemotherapy, one, and some of the trials that they say, if we take out the primary malignancy, the outcome of the patient or the overall survival of the patient is better one. So we can consider mammography as an assessment tool even in the stage 3 or stage 4 malignancies to know the response of the chemotherapy. It is my view about the mammography in relation to the stage 3 or stage 4 cancer, or where we are giving the anterior chemotherapy to know the exact extent of the response of the chemotherapy by the lump. This is my stake on the mammography in stage 3 or stage 4 cancers. But I would like to know whether there is any importance of this occurring or tethering of the skin to the lump anterior.
Shinde sir, as you have nicely said, puckering and involvement of the skin actually in the disease of the cancer process, it has an implication actually where you want to, patient wants to go for a BCT. That is one. Day by day, the patient are having more awareness and every patient wants to go for the BCT. That is one. Second, does it have an added value? Yes, sir, because in the procedures like skin sparing mastectomy, where you want to go for the secondary reconstruction in the immediate sitting, if the patient has taken a neoadjuvant chemotherapy, definitely it has a role to know what is the extent of involvement of the skin or whether it is totally puckered to the skin, and that we can assess with the MRI. That is second, sir. And third thing is, regarding if the patient is willing to go for MRM and she is planning for the reconstruction in the secondary sitting, sir, that has definitely no role, sir.
Okay, means the, if the patient is preferring for the MRM, it's okay that there may not be any importance of skin puckering, and very clearly
no importance. Because of the availability of the better neoadjuvant chemotherapy and the biological tumor markers, sir, we think we should not worry, sir.
You are right. That's what the student should take home message, that if the patient is going for BCT or the skin sparing mastectomy, occurring or tethering should be given priority of the importance of that. And if the patient is undergoing mastectomy or the MRM, then the role of tethering of the skin to the lump may not be having most of the, importance to the
It is for the theoretical importance, actually, sir. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank
Hello.
You, ma'am, for such a nice detailed talk. I would like to thank Dr. Rohit and Dr. Anjali for their elaborative talk, and many thanks to Dr. Kher for chairing the session.